King, all glorious above, and gratefully sing His wonderful love. Our shield and defender, the Ancient of Days, brilliant in splendor and girded with grace. Oh, tell of His might, oh, sing of His grace, whose robe is the light, whose canopy space. His chariots of wrath, the deep thunder clouds form, and dark is His path on the wings of the storm. Bountiful care, what tongue can recite? It breathes in the air, it shines in the light. It streams from the hills, it descends to the plain, and sweetly distills in the dew and the rain.
Revive us. Now, in our U.S. economy, the dollar is the medium of exchange, but in the kingdom of heaven, it's faith. Faith is the kingdom of exchange in heaven, or the medium of exchange in heaven. The Bible says, according to your faith, be it unto you. So whatever it is that we receive from God, it's got to be according to our faith. Not according to our friends, not according to our family, not according to our fortune, not according to our feelings, not according to our fate, but according to our faith. So not only do we need to possess a faith, but we have, and what we need is for faith to possess us. We need a mighty faith because we serve a mighty God. Amen? Amen. Doubt sees obstacles, faith sees the way. Doubt sees the darkest night, faith sees the brightest day. Doubt dreads to take a step, faith soars on high. Doubt questions who believes, and faith answers, 'tis I. But what we need is a strong faith, not a weak faith, not a so-so faith, but a strong faith. And so we're going to look today in the story, at a story in the Bible about a man who came to Jesus, and this man had a weak faith. He even had what we could call a superstitious faith, but he ultimately went from a weak faith to a strong faith to a saving faith. And that's what I want us to see today. I hope that in the end, you two are going to experience a growing faith from this as well. Now, the man in our story today had a son that was sick, and the nobleman, he wanted Jesus to heal his son. And so the dark soil of this man's problem is what became the soil in which the seed of faith would now grow. Now, do you want a strong faith? Would you like to really believe God and please God? I know you would. I know that's the desire of your heart, that you want to please God. You know, the Bible says without faith, though, it's impossible to please God. It takes faith to do that. No matter what else you do, no matter how well you sing, how sacrificially you give, or how well you serve, if you're not believing God when you do those things, you're not going to be pleasing God. Without faith, it's impossible to please God. And the greater your faith, the more glory God gets and the more pleased he is with it. And so by faith, man gives God pleasure. And by faith, then, God gives man treasure. When we have faith in God, it gives him pleasure. But when we have faith in God, he gives us treasure. He gives us the ability to do more than we ever thought was possible. So let's try to learn something about having a strong faith. Look at John chapter 4, verses 46 through 54. Read this in your Bible, or you can follow it on the screen. Here's what the scripture says. So he, Jesus, talking about Jesus here, he came again to Cana in Galilee, where he had made the water wine. And at Capernaum, there was an official whose son was ill. When this man heard that Jesus had come from Judea to Galilee, he went to him and asked him to come down and heal his son, for he was at the point of death. And so Jesus said to him, unless you see signs and wonders, you will not believe. Now, Jesus wasn't saying that, by the way. He wasn't saying that just as a statement of fact. But he was giving this man a rebuke. He was rebuking this man. Jesus is rebuking him for looking for signs and wonders there. Let's read on. It says, the official said to him, sir, come down before my child dies. And Jesus said to him, go, your son will live. And the man believed the word that Jesus spoke to him and went on his way. Now that's a phrase that ought to be underlined or highlighted in your Bible before we read on right there. It's the phrase, the man believed the word. You really ought to highlight that or underline that. See, what we have here is two polar opposites. On one hand, you have signs and wonders, but on the other hand, you have the word of God. At first, Jesus rebukes him. He says, unless you see signs and wonders, you will not believe. But then Jesus speaks to him, and now this man's transformed because he just simply believed the word. So what you have on one side is signs and wonders. What you have on the other is the word of God. And that's very key to what we're going to be talking about this morning. So I want you to just sort of wrap your mind around that. I want you to wrap your mind around the difference between signs and wonders and just simply believing the word of God. Okay? Say signs and wonders. It's over here, the word of God. It's over here. All right, let's read on. The man believed the word that Jesus spoke to him and went on his way. As he was going down, his servants met him and told him that his son was recovering. So he asked them the hour when he began to get better. And they said to him, yesterday at the seventh hour, the fever left him. Now that's probably around 1 o'clock according to their time, 1 p.m. in the afternoon. The father knew that that was the hour when Jesus had said to him, your son will live. And he himself believed in all his household. You say, well, I thought he already believed. Well, he did mention, and it's a different kind of belief. We'll talk about that in a moment. This was now the second sign that Jesus did when he had come from Judea to Galilee. And may God add his blessings on the preaching of his word. And all God's people said, amen. Amen. If you want to have a strong faith, if you really want to be able to lay hold of God's promises and believe God with a strong faith, then there's three things that I think this passage teaches us in regards to that. And I wrote that on your outline there, three things to help build a strong faith. Here's the first one. I want you to know, and I want us to look at the problem of a superficial faith. That's the starting point there, the problem of a superficial faith. See, at first, when this man met Jesus, his faith was almost non-existent. It almost wasn't even there. Look at this verse again on the screen or on your Bible, John 4:48. So Jesus said to him, "Unless you see signs and wonders, you will not believe." Did you see that? Unless you see the signs and wonders, you're just not going to believe. This man had a superficial faith that was based on signs and wonders. Evidently, his motto was, "I'll believe it when I see it," or "seeing is believing." He was saying, "Lord, if you'll just give me a sign, if you'll just give me a wonder, then I can believe it." So this man was being dependent upon his five physical senses. He wasn't being dependent upon the Word of God. See, probably this man had heard about Jesus turning water into wine at Cana. In fact, look again at the next verse on your Bible, John 4:46. This wasn't put there by accident. This is what it says. So Jesus came again to Cana in Galilee, where he had made the water wine, and at Capernaum there was an official whose son was ill. Now, Jesus had done a miracle. In fact, the first miracle we know about that Jesus performed was turning the water into wine, and this official had heard about it, and he was taken with it, or to put it in today's vernacular, we could probably say something, he was just blown away by this miracle. I mean, it just blew him away that there was somebody who could do this. I mean, here was somebody who could turn water into wine. Here's a miracle worker. But Jesus knew that miracles and signs and wonders are of little value when it comes to having a strong faith. Now, to be honest, you may not really believe that, though. You may not really believe that signs and wonders are of little value. As a matter of fact, most Christians don't really believe that. In fact, if you were like me when you were a younger Christian, and I was certainly like this when I was young in the faith and stuff, but perhaps if you were like me in your younger years, you too may have said, "God, I just want to see a miracle. God, show me a miracle. I want to see a genuine industrial strength miracle, God. I mean, I want to see something that cannot be explained any other way except that you supernaturally do something. I want to see that, God. Show me, God, show me." Now, I'm ashamed to admit it, but one time after I'd recommitted my life to Christ, one time I was sitting at home praying, and I stopped, and I asked God, I said, "God, would you move this chair from one side of the room to the other?" I asked God to do that. I said, "God, just move this chair from over here to over there." I said, "God, if you hear this prayer, move this chair." I mean, that's what I was praying. I said, "God, give me a sign. Let me see a sign. Is this what you want me to do? If this is what you want me to do," because I was praying about an issue, and I said, "If this is what you want me to do, then give me a sign." See, I wanted God to do something where I'd be able to say, "I've seen and I felt a miracle. God was really moving there." Now, let me ask you, how many of you have done something similar to that as well? Let me see your hands. Now, come on, I've already confessed you can't do. All right, good. Yeah. See, the truth is, there's something in us, there's something in our flesh that wants a sign, that wants a wonder, that wants a miracle. There's something in the flesh that just wants to see God do stuff. You know, "God, we just want to see you do stuff." And that's exactly what this official wanted. He wanted Jesus to do a miracle like turning water into wine. He came all the way from Capernaum, which was about 17 miles away. Now, it was a faith. Yes, it took faith to do that, but it was a superficial faith. Actually, it was a faith that was weak at its best. And he said, "Jesus, come down and heal my son." He said, "Anyone who can turn water into wine surely ought to be able to heal my son. You come do it." But Jesus rebukes him, and he said, "Except ye see signs and wonders, you'll not believe." Now, that's the same way they were when Jesus turned the water into wine. As a matter of fact, look at the next passage on the screen, John 2:23-25. Here's what it says. It says, "When he," Jesus, "was in Jerusalem at the Passover feast, many believed in his name when they saw the signs that he was doing." Including that. I mean, you say, but isn't that a good thing that they believe because they saw the signs? I mean, they believed Jesus when they saw the miracles he did. Well, let's read on. It says, "But Jesus, on his part, did not entrust himself to them." Wow. Do you know the word entrust and believe are the same word in the Greek there? It's the same word. So literally what that's saying is that they believed in Jesus, but he didn't believe in them. Wow. He did not entrust himself to them because he knew all people and needed no one to bear witness about man, for he himself knew what was in man. Jesus knew that these people who were following him, he knew that they were, quote, believing on him because of his miracles. They didn't have strong faith. In fact, about the best that they had was superficial or superstitious faith even. And you'd be surprised today at how many people still want signs and wonders. How many people still want that? They want visions. They want emotions. They want dreams. They want liver shivers. They want icicles going up and down their spines. But they want something so that they can say, see, now I can see that it's real. See, now I've seen, I've smelled, I've touched, and now I know it's real. God, give me a sign. God, give me a wonder. And I want to tell you, the world is full of people just like that. And many of them sit in churches all across America today, still wanting and demanding signs and wonders. Now, Jesus did perform miracles. There's no ifs, ands, and buts about that. Amen? He did perform miracles. And why did he do it? Why did he need to perform miracles? Here's the next key thought on your outline there. Jesus did miracles in order to authenticate his ministry. That's the primary reason. He did miracles in order to authenticate his ministry. Now, let me show you what I mean. The next verse on the screen, Acts 2:22, here's what it says. Men of Israel, hear these words. Jesus of Nazareth, a man attested to you by God with mighty works and wonders and signs that God did through him in your midst, and as you yourselves know. Now, what that verse is telling us there is that, yes, Jesus did signs and wonders. You can't take that out of the Word of God, nor should we want to take that out of the Word of God. Amen? I mean, it's true. God did signs and wonders. Jesus did signs and wonders. But why did he do it? Look at the next verse, John 20, verses 30 and 31. It says, now Jesus did many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book, but these are written so that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name. That's why. God did miracles in order to authenticate the ministry of Jesus Christ. But the miracle was not for the miracle's sake. The miracle was proof that Jesus was the Messiah and that people would believe on him and have eternal life. Not that they would seek a miracle, but the Messiah. Not that they would seek a sign, but a Savior. Now, the apostles also did signs and wonders, and some folks believe that Christians today ought to be doing signs and wonders. People believe that. They believe that Christians today and pastors and evangelists ought to be doing signs and wonders because, hey, they were done in the New Testament, so we should still be doing them today. But again, those signs and wonders had a specific purpose. In fact, look at the next verse, 2 Corinthians 12:12. It says, the signs of a true apostle. What kind of an apostle? The true apostle. A true apostle. There had to be a differentiation. There had to be a distinguishing mark there. The signs of a true apostle were performed among you with utmost patience, with signs and wonders and mighty works. Now, the apostle Paul, he also had power to do miracles and signs and wonders. And just as God authenticated the ministry of Jesus, he also used miracles as a way to authenticate the ministry of the apostles as well. Look at the next verse on the screen, Hebrews 2:4. It says, well, God also bore witness. How did he bear witness? How did he bear witness? How did he authenticate these ministries? By signs and wonders and various miracles and by gifts of the Holy Spirit distributed according to his will. You see, these apostles, they didn't have power to do signs and wonders according to their own wills. But God took these apostles, and because they were apostles and they were setting the foundation of the faith and the church, God authenticated them by signs and wonders. But folks, that's not the program for the whole church age. That's not what's supposed to be happening through the whole church age, because God has given us something better than signs and wonders, and I hope to show you that. Now listen, what's wrong with demanding a sign, though? What's wrong with what this official did when Jesus rebuked him and said, unless you see signs and wonders, you'll not believe? In fact, at one point, Jesus even said, an evil and adulterous generation seeks a sign. Wow, that's pretty strong language. An evil and adulterous generation seeks a sign. So why is that bad? Well, here's the next key thought on your outline there. Why is seeking a sign so bad? First of all, letter A, it's bad, frankly, because it dishonors God. It's dishonoring to God. It's dishonoring to God. Why is it dishonoring to God for you to say, God, give me a sign. Give me a wonder so that I can believe. Why is that dishonoring? I'll tell you why. It's because we have his word. It's dishonoring because we have his word. I mean, suppose I came to my son over here and I said, Doug, son, I want you to know that I love you. And because I love you, I've deposited $1,000 in the bank for you. I opened a brand new account, deposited $1,000 just for you. It's a good deal, huh? Yeah, it's a good deal. And I put it in the bank. I opened an account with your name on it. It's in the bank, Doug. It's right there. Now, suppose Doug said to me then, he said, well, Dad, how do I know that I have $1,000 in the bank? I mean, after all, you are a pastor. I doubt that you got $10 in the bank. How do I know you got $1,000 in the bank for me? That's a good question, right? And I'd say, well, son, because I just told you. And he'd say, well, Dad, it sure would mean a lot to me if you'd show me the deposit slip. Just take me down to the bank so I can see it with my own eyes. I mean, show me the money, Dad. Son, I just told you that it's there. That's fine, Dad, but show me the cash. Prove it to me that you did that. I just want to see something. I want something I can touch. I want something I can see. I want something I can smell. I can't just take your word for it, Dad. Well, I don't know about you, but if my son did that, I'd find that a bit dishonoring. I'd find that dishonoring to me. You know, there was a fellow in the Bible named Thomas, and we call him Doubting Thomas. Jesus was raised from the dead. The apostles were now preaching the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead according to his word. They're already doing that. But you know what Thomas said? Thomas said, unless I put my finger in the nail prints and put my hand in the wound on his side, I'll not believe. I just won't believe it. You know what Thomas was asking for? He was asking for a sign. Give me a sign. But look at what Jesus said in the next verse on the screen there, John 20:29. Now Jesus shows up and he says, okay, Thomas, you want a sign? Here it is, man. Put your hand in my side. Put your finger in the nail prints on my hand. Do that. And then Jesus said, he said to him, have you believed because you have seen me? In other words, Thomas didn't get a lot of credit for that. Basically, he's saying, Thomas, the only reason you believed is because you've seen me. That's the only reason you believe now. And then he says, but blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed. Blessed are them. You missed it, Thomas. Blessed are those who haven't, who have believed and not seen. Was it okay for Thomas to have believed in Jesus after he got his miracle, after he saw the nail prints in his hands? Was it okay for him to believe in Jesus? Well, yeah, it was okay. But he missed the special blessing of just simply believing the word of the Lord Jesus Christ. See, that takes real faith, to just simply believe without having to see, to just trust the word of God, to just trust him. So why is seeking a sign so bad? Well, first of all, it's dishonoring to God. Secondly, letter B, it can be very deceiving to you as well. Signs and wonders and asking for them can be very deceiving. They can easily become deceptive. You know, there is one day a man coming who's going to be Satan's Superman. He will be Satan incarnate. And you know what he's going to do to authenticate his ministry, this Antichrist? You know what he's going to do? He's going to do signs and wonders. He's going to authenticate his ministry with signs and wonders. Look at the next verse up on the screen, 2 Thessalonians 2:9-10. It says, the coming of the lawless one. And by the way, aren't we now in a lawless society? Haven't we come to that place now where we just see lawlessness abound? Not only around the rest of the world, and even secular media now is saying the lawlessness that's extended around the world has now made its ways to the shores of the United States of America. And it's true. We see lawlessness now just spreading everywhere. But the coming of the lawless one is by the... And by the way, I also believe that that lawlessness is a precursor to the coming of the Antichrist, who is the lawless one. He is the epitome of lawlessness. Amen? Amen. So we see all these things happening. It's anyway. The coming of the lawless one is by the activity of Satan with all power and false signs and wonders and with all wicked deception for those who are perishing because they refused to love the truth and so be saved. You see, the reason they weren't saved was because they were looking for signs and wonders instead of looking for just the truth. Listen, the point of that verse is that the Antichrist will be able to make a lot of folks believe that black is white and good is bad, and he'll get you to cut your mother's throat with a smile on your face. I mean, because of the ability that he'll have to deceive with all power and signs and lying wonders. So the devil can do signs and wonders, and he'll do them through his Antichrist. Matter of fact, look at this next verse on the screen. I just thought I'd show you this since we were in this area in the neighborhood. I'd show you this, Revelation 13:13-14. Now, this is speaking of the false prophet, who's the sinister minister of propaganda here for the Antichrist that's coming. And look at what it says. It says, it, speaking of the false prophet, performs great signs, even making fire come down from heaven to earth in front of people. And watch this now. And by the signs that it is allowed to work in the presence of the beast, that's the Antichrist, it deceives those who dwell on earth, telling them to make an image for the beast that was wounded by the sword and yet lived. The propaganda false prophet of the Antichrist has the ability to do signs and wonders to the point that people will literally worship Satan's Superman. So listen, to demand signs and wonders not only dishonors God, but secondly, it can become very deceptive to you. In fact, it says that he made fire come down from heaven. So what could that be? Well, I don't know, maybe some kind of cosmic dazzling display that he performs, maybe an atomic explosion of some kind, or some kind of just bright light display in the heavens or something. We're not sure what it is, but it is powerful enough, though, to cause a lot of people to worship the Antichrist. Let me give you an example. Suppose I say, Oh God, I just want to know whether I'm right with you or not. God, I want to know whether I'm going to heaven or not. Oh God, give me a sign. Let me see a sign. Am I all right with you? Am I going to heaven? Now I don't just say, Lord, would you move a chair across the room? But what I say is, Lord, just give me a sign in the heavens. Let me see something, God. And all of a sudden, I see shooting stars go across the sky. Flashes of light just going across the sky. And then I lean back and I say, all right, God. Now I know I've got it made. Now I know that I'm going to heaven because there's a sign. So now I know. But then on judgment day, I stand before the Lord and I've never repented of my sin. I've never trusted Christ as my Savior and Lord. I've never been born twice. And so my soul's dropping into hell. And I say, God, how can you do that to me? You gave me a sign. And the devil just laughs and he says, you fool. God didn't give you that sign. I did. And I did it to deceive you, to keep you out of heaven. You know, the Bible says that if it were possible, Satan would deceive even the very elect. So don't you let some wonder worker, some sign giver, some soothsayer, some emissary of Satan deceive you so that you go off following after something else because of some sign or some wonder. Don't do that. Jesus said a perverse and adulterous generation seeks a sign. So it's dishonoring to God, and it may be very deceptive to you to do that. Well, let's move on to the second point. There are things that I want you to see in this passage that will help build a strong faith. The first is the problem of a superficial faith. So we know that we've got to get past that. We've got to get past the need to see signs and wonders. We've got to get past this need for miracles in order to believe. And the second thing then is this. Then comes the progression of a strong faith. The progression of a strong faith. Now I want you to see how this man, this official, moved from a weak faith or a superficial faith to a strong faith. And I want to give you the steps he took here because there are some very progressive steps that moved him from signs and wonders to just believing God's word. Here's step number one on your outline there. Step number one, he heard the word of God. That's what he did. He heard the word of God. Now again, this next verse on the screen is John chapter 4, verse 50. Or you can see it in your Bible either way. Jesus said to him, go, your son will live. The man believed the word that Jesus spoke to him and he went on his way. The word that Jesus did what? Spoke to him. The first thing that happened was that this man heard the word of God. Jesus spoke and he heard. Now let me tell you what faith is. Faith is not naming it and claiming it. That's not faith. And faith is not just receiving from God what you want. Listen, faith is accepting from God what he gives. That's what faith is. God's given you some stuff and faith is just simply being able to receive it. I receive it by faith. I receive what God has given me. He heard the word and he accepted it. Now this man who came to Jesus, he was an official. And as an official, he was used to telling other people what to do. I mean, he's used to commanding. And so he started by trying to tell Jesus what to do. He said, sir, come down before my child dies. Come on with me, Jesus. Jesus, you come with me. I know you're busy, but you stop. You come with me. I need you to come with me right now, sir. Come with me. But notice what Jesus said to him in verse 50. He said, go, your son will live. See, the official said, come, but Jesus said, no, you go. He said, no, you go. Jesus said, you go because you're not here to tell me what to do. You're not here to demand of me or to command me. You're here to listen to me, to hear me, and to get a word from me. That's what you're here to do. Amen? Amen. Look at this next verse on the screen, Romans 10, 14, and 17. It says, how then will they call on him in whom they have not believed? And how are they to believe in him of whom they have never heard? And how are they to hear without someone, what? Preaching or telling them. So faith comes from hearing, and hearing through the word of Christ. Now folks, if you want strong faith, you've got to hear the word of God. You've got to hear it. In fact, let me tell you what faith is. Faith is simply taking God at his word. Does that sink into you? Does that get into you? Faith is just taking God at his word. The official heard the word. He heard what Jesus told him. And that's very important because if you want strong faith, you too must hear what God says to you. And if you want others to have strong faith, then they must also hear. So that means that we must also tell. Amen? Amen. For others to hear, we have to tell. We have to share the word of God. Amen? Amen? We have to distribute it. That's why Paul said, how can people hear without a preacher? Okay, step number one, he heard the word of God. Step number two, he believed the word of God. He just simply believed it. Now again, this verse, John chapter 4, verse 50 up on the screen, it says, Jesus said to him, go, your son will live. The man believed the word. He believed it. Now, this is step number two because it's not enough to simply hear the word. That's not enough. I mean, you can sit here this morning, you can hear me preach, and But if you don't believe the word of God, you're not going to have any faith. You got to believe it. You say, well, Pastor, I just can't believe. That's my problem. I just can't believe. Well, with all due respect, may I tell you that that's baloney? Because you can believe if you want to. Oh, no, Pastor, some of the stuff in the Bible, that's really out there. I can't believe that. Yes, you can. Yes, you can. You can believe it if you want to. See, the Bible says that he that believeth not God hath made him a liar, and God is no liar. Amen? You say, well, I have an intellectual problem with this whole God thing. I have intellectual problems with the whole God thing. No, you don't. In fact, let's just be honest. For people who choose not to believe, the problem isn't intellectual. The problem is moral. The problem of believing isn't in your head. It's in your heart. You say, but Pastor, I know some intellectuals who don't believe the Bible. Well, I know some intellectuals who do. Well, you might say, I know some very foolish people who believe the Bible. Well, I know some very foolish people who don't. Listen, what we believe is not contrary to reason, but it goes beyond reason. It goes beyond that. It's not contrary to it. It goes beyond it. Faith is a gift of God. And if a person wants to believe, God will enable that person to believe, because God is not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. He wants all people to believe. So you can believe if you want to believe. If you want to believe God, he'll enable you to believe. You see, faith is not seeing signs and wonders. You know what faith is? Here's the next key thought on your outline. Here's another definition of faith. Faith is response to the character of God. That's what faith is too. It's a response to the character of God. You know, that's why when he came to this earth, he left behind all the glory. He left behind all the splendor, all the majesty that were his in heaven. He kept his deity, but he took on frail human flesh. He walked in sandaled feet. When we saw him, the Bible says that there was no form or comeliness or beauty that we should desire him. Jesus didn't come in a jeweled chariot or a display of glory or anything like that, but Jesus came through the portals of a virgin's womb, born in a smelly stable, worked in a carpenter's shop, and grew up in a very humble home. And yet, there was something in Jesus Christ. There was in him the grace and the glory and the fullness of God, so much so that when a man's heart was right, Jesus knew it. He knew it. And this official's heart got right with Jesus. And when his heart got right, he heard Jesus speak and he believed him. He believed him. Listen, when your heart is right, your heart will respond to the word of God in faith. Just like your eye responds to light when your eye is right, or your ear responds to sound when your ear is right. Listen, your heart will respond to God when your heart is right. The heart's response to the character of God is always faith. When we finally connect with the true character of God, we can't help but believe him. Because God is God. Amen? But it's not the result of signs and wonders. Now, you see, when God speaks to you through his word, there's something in you that says, that's true. I believe it. And the Holy Spirit whispers amen to your heart, and then he imparts faith to you. And that faith blossoms. Step number one, you hear the word of God. Step number two, you believe the word of God. Step number three came when he obeyed the word of God. When he obeyed the word of God. Look at this next verse again, John chapter 4, verse 50. Jesus said to him, go, your son will live. And the man believed the word that Jesus spoke to him, and he went on his way. The man now does exactly what Jesus tells him to do. He said, go, and the man went. This man does what Jesus tells him to do. This is what the Bible calls the obedience of faith. In Romans 16:26, he calls it the obedience of faith. You know what real faith is? Again, here's another definition of faith. Here's the next key thought. Real faith is just simply belief with legs on it. I like that. That's faith. It's belief with legs on it. Look at what James told us in the next verse on the screen there, James 2:26. James says, for as the body apart from the spirit is dead, so also faith apart from works is dead. Listen, you'll never know what strong faith is all about if you don't exercise your faith and obey the word of God. And how important that is. You hear the word of God, you believe the word of God, and then you obey the word of God. Had this man still had his weak, superficial faith, he'd still be there begging Jesus for some kind of a sign or some kind of a wonder that his son had been healed. Show me something. Help me to know that my son's really been healed. But instead, he hears Jesus, he believes Jesus, and then he just does exactly what Jesus tells him to do. That brings us to the fourth and final step of the progression of strong faith. And this really reveals his exercise of faith here. Here's step number four. He's resting now in the word of God. He's resting in the word of God. Now, this next passage in your Bible or on the screen, John 4, 51 through 54. It says, as he was going down, his servants met him and told him that his son was recovering. Now pay attention to this. Watch this, okay? As he was going down, his servants met him and told him that his son was recovering. So he asked them the hour when he began to get better. And they said to him, watch this, he said, yesterday at the seventh hour, the fever left him. Now the father knew that was the hour when Jesus had said to him, your son will live. And he himself believed in all his household. The point is this, that happened 24 hours after this man's son was healed. A full day later. He said, when did my son get healed? The servant said, about 1 in the afternoon. The man said, well, that's at the same time that I was talking to Jesus yesterday when he said, go, thy son lives. I said, isn't that wonderful? Now listen, if you had a son that was only 17 miles away and Jesus said, go thy way, thy son lives, what would you have done? I can tell you what most of us would have done. We'd have hot-footed it straight home. I mean, we wanted to see if our son lived or not. 17 miles, man. I mean, 17 miles away, you can make that by foot in 5 or 6 hours. Or within 2 hours by chariot. I mean, this was a nobleman. Certainly he must have had the ability to ride or been riding. But 24 hours had passed and he'd not gone home yet. Why not? Why didn't he go home? Why did he wait? Well, we're not really sure except for this. I think that maybe it was because he was already so tired and so exhausted from sitting up day and night with his sick son. And he's just completely exhausted. And so when Jesus said, go, your son lives, he just took a deep breath and he said, thank you, Jesus. And he went someplace, laid down, and went to sleep. And just rested. Have you ever been there? Have you ever been to that place? I'm so tired. I've been working so hard at this, and I've been so worried. I've been praying about this. I've been worried about it for so long. And at some point, God just says, it's okay. Just relax. It's going to be all right. And you just sit down. And for the first time in days, perhaps, you just go to sleep. You just relax. See, this is what I call the rest of faith. In fact, here's a passage of scripture I love that I put in your study guide as well. It's Psalm 37, 5-7. It says this, it says, commit your way to the Lord, trust in him, and he will act. You can trust that. He will act. And he'll bring forth your righteousness as the light and your justice as the noonday. Be still, or rest, that's another way of saying rest, before the Lord and wait patiently for him. This official isn't demanding proof. He's not even hot-footing at home to see if it's happened yet, because the rest of faith is the mark of a really strong faith. This passage says, trust in the Lord and he will act, and he'll bring forth the righteousness as the light. Have you ever thought about that? The Lord says that when you rest in me, it's like the sun coming up. In other words, you can't hurry the sunrise, but you can't stop it either. And you can't hurry God, but you can't stop him either. And the Bible says that he that believes in him shall not make haste. And so here's this official who's just gone from a superficial faith to a strong faith. He hears the word of the Lord. He believes the word of God. He obeys the word of God. And now he rests in the word of God. And if you don't learn how to do this, now listen to your pastor, brothers and sisters, listen. If you don't learn how to do this, you're going to be blown about. You're going to be stampeded by all kinds of things in life. All kinds of, you're going to be in turmoil your entire life. You're going to be upset your entire life. You're going to be agitated your entire life. You're going to go from one catastrophe to another your entire life until you learn to just trust the word of God and rest in him. It's important you learn this. So what you need to do is to get a bulldog grip on the word of God and stop trying to live by emotions and feelings and visions and dreams and signs and wonders. I mean, those things may have their purpose, but we are to live by faith in the word of God. Amen? Amen. That's how we're to live. Now listen, let's say that I get sick or I have a loved one who gets sick. Can I pray and ask God to heal that loved one? Absolutely. Say yes. Of course you can and you should. And does God heal and answer prayer today, even miraculously? Yes, of course he does. And could that be a sign and a wonder? Yes, it could be. It most certainly could be. But that's not something that causes me to believe in him. That will not cause me. It might increase my faith a little bit here or there, but that's not why I believe in him. And it's not the cause of my belief. And I don't need that to believe in him. I mean, God doesn't always heal the sick. Sometimes we pray and pray and pray that they get better. And they don't. I come to God and I ask for healing. And I thank God that he does heal. And I thank God that he uses doctors to heal. God has healed me before. God's healed me. And he's done it on occasion by a doctor. He's used my wonderful doctor to heal me at times. Is it wrong to go to a doctor? No, it's not wrong to go to a doctor. I heard some people say, well, we just need to trust prayer and forget the doctor. No, God gave us doctors. In fact, in Matthew 9:12, Jesus said, they that are whole don't need a doctor, but they that are sick. In other words, they that are sick do. And you say, well, he was talking about spiritual things there. He's talking about spiritual things. Yeah, but he used physical truth to illustrate spiritual things with. And he wouldn't illustrate spiritual things with a lie. Amen?
Amen.
So God, Jesus endorsed doctors. See, what you do is you pray for healing, and then you go to the doctor and do what the doctor tells you to do. It's all a part of obedience of faith. Amen?
Amen?
And that brings us to the third thing I want you to see today about having a strong faith. So far we've talked about the problem of superficial faith, the progression of strong faith, but here's number three. I also want you to see the provision of a saving faith found here. The provision of a saving faith. Now again, this next verse is John 4:53. We're talking about the provision of a saving faith here. And John 4:53 says, the Father knew that was the hour when Jesus said to him, your son will live. And he himself believed, and all his household. You say, well, wait a minute. I thought the scripture said he already believed a couple of verses early. He said he believed. Yeah, yeah. But this is a different kind of belief. See, he's moved up another notch on the faith scale. This man believes now not just in a miracle worker, but in a Messiah. This man is born again because now he believes in Jesus as his Lord and Savior. Now, can you imagine this man getting home? I mean, what a time of rejoicing there must have been when he finally got home, because he sees his son. His son's up. His son is alive and he's well. And the man, they're all rejoicing. The man sees his family. And the man says, now, wait a minute before we get to it. Listen, I got to tell you guys about Jesus. I got to tell you about this man that I believed in and that we're all going to believe in. Yes, honey, you're going to believe in Jesus. Yes, son, you're going to believe in Jesus too. There's no other option, because I'm telling you, he's the real deal. You got to believe in him. And he and his whole family came to a saving faith in Christ. In fact, that's what the whole Gospel of John is written about. John said, these things are written that you might believe that Jesus is the Christ, so that believing you might have life through his name.
Amen.
Jesus didn't come to earth as a healer. He came as a Savior. Look at the next verse on the screen. Luke 19:10. It says, for the Son of Man came to seek and to save the lost. Say that with me. For the Son of Man came to seek and to save the lost. And so because Jesus didn't come to earth as a healer, he didn't heal everybody. You know, if he had come to earth as a healer, he would have, what? Healed everybody. He just healed us all. That's not why he came. In fact, Jesus went to the pool of Bethesda, and there were many people there that were sick. He only healed one. That's because the miracles Jesus did do were signs that pointed to the greater miracle, which is the new birth. Folks, that's the greatest miracle of all. Jesus still does miraculous things today, but we're not to put our trust in miracles, but we are to put our trust in Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Suppose that this son of this official had gotten healed. Suppose he got healed, but he never got saved. Think about that. He got healed, but what if he never got saved? All that would happen is that he'd live a few more years, and then he'd die, and then he'd go to hell. Listen, you hear the Word of God, you believe the Word of God, you obey the Word of God, and then you rest in the Word of God.
Amen.
And folks, whatever else God does, you can be certain then that it's going to be for your best. Whatever else he does, it'll be for your best. I want to read something to you that was written by a man who was sick, and I'm going to read this verbatim. Because when I read it the first time, I was just kind of blown away by this, and I think it's truly amazing. I want you to listen carefully, because this is very pertinent to what we're talking about here. This letter he wrote is called Why I Follow Christ. This is a sick and dying man who wrote this. He's dying of cancer, and this is what he said. He said, I've not seen clear statistical evidence that fewer Christians die from cancer than non-believers, or that they are immune to a greater degree from the diseases that afflict the human race. In fact, the kindest and most selfless people I've known have had more than their fair share of bad health. The fact that they belong to Christ did not insulate them from disease. Therefore, I will not follow Christ for promised healing. Now, I will not deny or dispute evidence of restoration of health. In fact, I will rejoice at every recovery of what seems to be a hopeless threatened death. I will not hesitate to pray for recovered health for my loved ones and acquaintances. I will set no limits on what God may do, but I will not follow Christ for promised healing. I see no sign that Christians escape disaster or accident more often than others. I've helped dear friends empty muddy water out of dresser drawers because of a disastrous flood. I remember as a child taking clothes to the house of a widow whose house had burned down. A bullet makes no detour around the body of a believer. Therefore, I will not follow Christ for any protection from disaster. However, I will not scoff at amazing survivals or deny that providence has and continues to work for the good of God's own. I will continue to pray for protection from wicked men and from tragedy. But I will not follow Christ for promised protection from accident or catastrophe. I do not observe that Christians are especially favored with prosperity. Like James, we've seen the rich oppressing the poor, and justice is rarely perfect in this world. The psalmist has said that he has not seen the righteous forsaken or his seed begging bread. And in the basic needs of life, that's certainly true. But all of us have known people of integrity who have not prospered. Therefore, I will not follow Christ for promised freedom from physical want or the hope of affluence. I'm not sure that Christians have stronger personalities or fewer neuroses than non-believers. I do know that there's no bitterness like religious bitterness and no arrogance more insufferable than that. I've watched Christians suffer emotional and mental disabilities. And though it may seem heretical, I'm not sure that I would even enjoy living in a house with either the Apostle Peter or even Paul. I thought that was kind of interesting. God wills that the mind of Christ be formed in us, and there's no doubt in my mind that the Christian's attitudes and actions will be improved by his Christianity, though. But I will not follow Christ for any promise of personality enhancement or perfection. But now listen to this. Why then follow Christ? Why then become a disciple of Jesus when life may become even more complicated, as Jesus himself often warned? For one reason alone. In Jesus, we behold the true face of God. He is the truth, the everlasting truth, God in the flesh. I know that in his life, death, and resurrection, I am reconciled to God, the giver of life. I believe that nothing can separate me from the love of God. He has all power and goodness. I trust in him and his promises. To him I offer my life, damaged or whole, brief or full of years, it matters not. He is the one certain thing in an uncertain world. He is to be worshipped, not so something will happen to me or to the world, something already has happened to me and to the world, but because he is God, who through Christ has reconciled the world to himself. He saves me. He's my justification. He is the center that holds. To worship the God of our salvation, to offer sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, that alone is our vocation. We offer our lives to God, not so as to be healthy, wealthy, or wise, not even so as to gain strength to be able to do great things for him. We offer our lives to him because he alone has claim upon us. End quote. Well, I don't know about you, but I think that's just wonderful. What a wonderful letter. Here's a dying and sick man who really understood what it means to be a faith follower of Jesus Christ. Don't look for some sign or some wonder or some miracle that's going to somehow make you a believer if you're not already a believer. And don't look for some sign or wonder or some miracle to confirm things that you know are already true or that God already wants to give you. You don't need that. You've got the Word of God. Jesus is the Savior who lived and suffered and died in our place and then rose from the dead in order to save us. And if you simply trust Him as Savior, then I promise you by the authority of his word that he will save you. Amen?
Amen?
He'll do that. Jesus will save. He'll keep you. And one day, we're all going to be gathered together around the throne to give praise forever and ever to our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. You know, it's okay to believe in a miracle working God because he is. He's a miracle working God. But we put our trust not in the miracles, but in Jesus Christ and in Jesus alone. And when you do that, you go from a superficial faith to a strong faith, to a saving faith, to greater faith. And ultimately, isn't that what matters? Serving and knowing Jesus Christ. Amen?
Amen?
Would you stand? Let's pray together. Our gracious Heavenly Father, I pray that everyone, every single person here has given their heart to you. And I pray that they're saved, Lord. But if there's someone here, Lord, who's not saved, or they're just not sure of their salvation, Father, then I pray that they would come to you. If you've never prayed really to receive Christ as your Lord and Savior, you might pray something like this. Just say, Dear God, I'm a sinner. I know it. I'm lost. And I know that my sin deserves judgment. But I need mercy, Lord. I need mercy. And so I repent of my sin. I'm sorry for my sin, Jesus. I'm sorry. I turn from it. And Lord, I open my heart and I open my life to you. And I receive you now as my Lord and Savior. Just tell him that. By faith, Lord, I receive you as my Lord and Savior. Forgive me of my sin. Cleanse me and save me right now. Lord, I don't ask for a feeling. I don't look for a sign. I just simply believe your word. That if I would come to you, that you would save me. I trust you now to save me. Thank you for saving me. And Lord, now I will obey your word. I will do what you told me to do. I will make the decision to follow you every day. And I will make my decision to follow you public. I'll tell others about you. And I'll be obedient to be baptized. I'll not be ashamed of you, Lord, for you are my God. You are my Savior. And now, Lord, I pray that you would just increase the faith of every person here. Give them a strong faith. Give them a saving faith. And help their faith to grow even more in the days and weeks ahead. Thank you for your word, Lord. Thank you for the service this morning. Father, may you just be with your people now as we go home and as we share and have fellowship one with another. We love you and praise you in Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen. God bless you. Thank you for being here today. You guys have a great day.